The unification of general relativity and quantum field theory is one of the biggest unsolved mysteries of our time. But where exactly lies the problem? I wanted to know this in detail, so I tried to find out why exactly quantization of gravity does not work. Well, I failed. Instead, I found out how it does work. This video is not an introduction to general relativity or to quantum field theory. I will just give a brief overview of some of their most important principles. If you are entirely new to things like black holes, quarks and the Higgs boson, then you probably should watch some other videos first. But now, what is that relativity and quantum theory? We have special and general relativity, and we have non-relativistic and relativistic quantum mechanics and quantum field theory. The contradiction only consists between general relativity and quantum field theory. Special relativity explains the strange behavior of light. For instance, when the Earth on its orbit around the Sun approaches a star or departs from it, then we measure that the speed of the light which reaches us from the star is precisely the same in both cases. How can that be? Special relativity explains this as follows. Space and time are not independent of each other, but they combine to a four-dimensional space-time. When you move through space, your time runs slower. General relativity is the theory of gravity. It describes gravity as a geometric effect, as the curvature of four-dimensional spacetime. How can we conceive this? Consider you are on the surface of a giant sphere. Then you launch two aircraft on parallel routes, for instance from the equator straight to the south. Then they will, just by themselves, approach each other, and at the south pole they will meet. Now we could conclude that there is an attractive force between the aircrafts. But actually, this is just a geometric effect on the curved two-dimensional surface of a sphere. With gravity, it's just the same. We experience it as an attractive force, but actually it's just a geometric effect in the curved four-dimensional spacetime. The core of general relativity, the mathematical description of this curvature, is a set of differential equations, the so-called Einstein field equations. Using these equations, we can describe the universe on a large scale and mathematically describe fascinating phenomena like black holes and the Big Bang. Quantum mechanics describes particles as waves using the so-called Schrödinger equation, again a differential equation. This equation makes it possible to calculate, for instance, spectral lines and a periodic table of elements. But now a contradiction to relativity emerges. Special relativity only allows for speeds slower than the vacuum speed of light. The Schrödinger equation doesn't have this kind of speed limit. This contradiction can be resolved, which leads us to the unification of special relativity with quantum mechanics, the so-called relativistic quantum mechanics. Again, its core is a differential equation, the so-called Dirac equation. This equation is relevant until today. It describes the behavior of quarks and leptons. Quarks are the constituents of protons and neutrons, which make up the atomic nuclei, and the electron is one of the leptons. Can we also unify quantum theory with general relativity, with space-time curvature? Yes, we can. Using the so-called spin connection, we can combine the Dirac equation and Einstein's field equations to a unified differential equation. The contradiction only emerges when we take the last step to quantum field theory. The Dirac equation describes just a single particle, for instance an electron. When we want to describe multiple particles, it is not sufficient to describe each one using a Dirac equation. Instead, we must translate the Dirac equation to a new mathematical structure, the so-called Fock space. There, the number of particles can also change, and it can even have a quantum uncertainty. This transition from one particle to many particles is the so-called second quantization. Again, we obtain a differential equation, but for an infinite number of particles. This kind of differential equation isn't usually solved using normal methods. Instead, we apply the so-called time-ordered perturbation theory. To study the behavior of the smallest particles of the universe, we decompose this behavior into sequences of elementary processes, which we describe using so-called Feynman diagrams. A Feynman diagram is a shorthand for a mathematical formula, an integral. However, there is also an illustrative interpretation for it. For instance, we can interpret this particular Feynman diagram as a collision between an electron and a positron. The positron is the antiparticle of the electron, thus it moves in the opposite direction of this arrow. In the collision, the electron and the positron annihilate each other, generating a quantum of gamma rays, a photon. In this example, electromagnetic interaction is intermediated by a particle, a photon, a so-called intermediate particle. From the photon, a muon and an anti-muon emerge. Again, the anti-particle moves in the opposite direction of this arrow. As I said, all of this is just an illustrative interpretation of an integral. When we actually want to apply Feynman diagrams in a calculation, we carry out the sum of a large number of Feynman diagrams. In this sense, all of these illustrative processes happen simultaneously. The larger the number of Feynman diagrams, the more precise is my calculation. For a rough overview, we can get along with just two Feynman diagrams. For high precision calculations, this number can grow to many thousands. Using this method, we can obtain an astonishing precision. We can, for instance, compute the so-called g-factor of the electron up to 11 decimals, and the result coincides precisely with the experiments. Time-ordered perturbation theory is the most successful physical theory we ever had. Now, when we want to combine this with general relativity, time-ordered perturbation theory does no longer work. When we try to describe gravity using intermediate particles, the calculations yield infinity. These are the so-called non-renormalizable divergences which prevent us from unifying general relativity with quantum field theory. There are very interesting approaches to overcome these problems. The best known one is string theory. As of today, there is, however, no experimental evidence that any of these approaches might be close to reaching its goal. So, time-ordered perturbation theory does not work for gravity. This method is very important, but in the end it is just a calculation method. Is this really the whole story? Isn't there a fundamental mathematical contradiction between both theories? My search for the contradiction starts at the point where both theories are still compatible. That's the Dirac equation for a single particle. This differential equation can still be solved by normal means, and we can apply the so-called spin connection to combine it with general relativity. It lacks, however, the essential aspect of quantum field theory, the transition from one particle to many particles, the so-called second quantization. So my question about the contradiction, my question about the question reads, at which point does time-ordered perturbation theory become indispensable? I studied the mathematical structures of second quantization very thoroughly, and I found the point where we can no longer solve the differential equation using normal means. This point is the distinction between particles and antiparticles. Using Feynman diagrams, we can, broadly speaking, let the antiparticles travel against the direction of the arrows. The description of pair annihilation and creation, however, only works so far using Feynman diagrams. But what does that mean, only works so far? Again, this leads me to the question, is this just a calculation method which does not work? Isn't there a fundamental mathematical contradiction between both theories? So my research question, my question about the question, reads, why is it not possible to describe pair annihilation and pair creation using a differential equation? We are now getting to my own results, the results of many years of slow but thorough scientific research. Well, I didn't find the fundamental contradiction. Instead, I solved the problem. I actually found a method how to describe pair annihilation and creation using a differential equation. This animation shows how two wave packets, one with electrons and one with positrons, annihilate each other. This blue glow depicts gamma rays generated by the annihilation of electron-positron pairs. Also, we can let two wave packets of gamma rays collide. Where the wave packets overlap, a glow emerges. These are newly created electron-positron pairs. These animations haven't been painted using graphic software, but they have been calculated by solving a differential equation of quantum field theory. So my search for the fundamental contradiction between general relativity and quantum field theory was a failure. Instead, I found a new method of second quantization, which leads to a differential equation which can be solved by normal means, so it is compatible with general relativity. I was looking for the question, but instead I found the answer, a method how to quantize gravity. Well, things happen. You don't always find what you're looking for. What shall we do about this now? First of all, this is just the beginning. To actually apply the new method to general relativity, we have to include the spin connection. That's a lot of work. Also, I can only describe electrons, positrons and photons so far. The extension to the full standard model of quantum field theory, including quarks, leptons and interactions, including the Higgs boson, is a lot of work too, probably even more. Anyway, I don't see any further fundamental obstacles on this long way. The road to quantum gravity is clear. There is, however, one thing we won't get this way. Since I am working without Feynman diagrams, I don't describe gravity using intermediate particles, so my quantum gravity won't feature gravitons. Many will view this as an aesthetic deficiency. Instead, my method also allows for quantization of noncommutative geometry. What is that? Noncommutative geometry is the consistent further development of general relativity. Instead of just gravity, it describes all forces as geometry on a curved spacetime. This curved spacetime has, however, not only the four usual dimensions, but some additional discrete extra dimensions. As an example, we can see here a two-dimensional curved surface with one discrete extra dimension, which consists of four points. That's a two-dimensional curved universe with four sheets. This formula describes a non-commutative spacetime of particular interest. From the curvature of this spacetime, we obtain all fundamental forces of physics: gravity, electromagnetic and weak interaction, color interaction and the Higgs boson. This tiny formula unifies all fundamental forces of physics by ascribing them to geometry on a non-commutative spacetime. Doesn't this mean that this is the long-sought theory of everything? This formula has been known since 1996, but it is not widely recognized because it cannot be quantized. It has the same problem as general relativity has. Trying to apply time-ordered perturbation theory leads to non-renormalizable divergences. My new quantization method solves this problem. This makes this formula a hot candidate for a theory of everything. Further information, including my scientific publications, is available at www.peter.gerwinski.de/physics. Thank you.